Once again, ladies and gents, I'm AndHeDrewB, and this is the Sum 41 Retrospective, Episode 8. In this episode, we're talking about the band's sixth studio record, 13 Voices, released on October 7th, 2016. And it's a day I remember well, a day which I was anticipating for quite some time. After all, 13 Voices marks the longest gap between Sum 41 records. So when the music video for Fake My Own Death dropped back in June 2016, man, I was excited! And I think a lot of Sum 41 fans felt the same. I mean, there was a point where the band's future seemed uncertain due to particular events, but now we'd be awaiting the release of a brand new Sum 41 record. But that was more than 4 years ago. The initial hype has long since died down, and now 13 Voices is a part of Sum 41 history. So the question is, does 13 Voices still hold up, or did the excitement make it seem better than it actually was? Well, it's time to find out as we take a look at 13 Voices. Last episode, we took a look at 2011's Screaming Bloody Murder, a record that was dark, raw, and emotional. Although it was well received by most fans, the record received mixed to poor critical reception, and it didn't sell very well. After the release of the record, the band toured extensively over the next couple years. Not only did they tour for Screaming Bloody Murder, but they also toured for the 10th anniversary of Does This Look Infected? And so after a ton of shows and being on the road for so long, the band had burnt themselves out. And after spending way too much time with each other, internal tensions started to fester. And this leads to our first significant event, the departure of Steve-O-32. On April 17th, 2013, Steve-O announced that he was leaving Sum 41. The public was shocked, fans were outraged.
Mass hysteria!
So why did Steve-O leave? Well, there's a few reasons. Well, like I mentioned, extensive touring left the band burnt out. And playing the same material continuously night after night can eventually wear on a person, and you could end up sick of playing the music that you once loved. Steve-O had also just recently had a kid and he wanted to spend more time with his family. A common sentiment for anybody who's been away on tour for multiple years. I had also mentioned that relations in the band had suffered, but it may have been his relationship with Derek that suffered the most, as Derek's struggles with alcoholism made him difficult to be around. But we'll get more into that later. And so, we must now say goodbye to Steve-O-32. He would be missed for his fierce drumming, loud brash comedy, in-your-face antics, and of course his portrayal of pain-for-pleasure frontman, Pain.
Drunk as fuck!
And so what became of Steve-O? Well, believe it or not, he actually went on to become a realtor.
Hey, it's Steve-O! Come see me 10 to 1 at my open house, 780 East Paseo, El Mirador, Palm Springs.
From playing arenas to selling houses. And according to some reviews online, he seems to be pretty good at it. Well, if you're gonna go from rock star to realtor, you might as well do it well. Heavily touring from 2010 to 2012 put a huge strain on the band. Hell, they all felt like calling it quits at one point, just so they could do something else and something different. So towards the end of 2012, the band announced that they would be taking a break from touring in 2013, and they'd be taking the time to rest and begin work on new material. However, some unexpected and near-fatal developments put a wrench in those plans. The Sum 41 documentary Don't Try This at Home, which was shot during the making of Screaming Bloody Murder, showcased that Derek had been drinking heavily throughout that record's creation process. And throughout the Screaming Bloody Murder tour, his drinking only increased. It got to the point where a bottle of vodka was delivered to his house daily, and he was spending upwards of $1,500 on alcohol per week. And eventually, his excessive drinking caught up with him. In April 2014, while pouring himself a drink, Derek collapsed. He woke up in the hospital a week later after being put in a medically induced coma. He had suffered both liver and kidney failure as a result of excessive drinking. There were moments where the doctors weren't sure if they could save him. He had to be continually rushed to intensive care while at the hospital. He nearly died 5 times. He was told if he had one more drink, he would die. It's kinda scary to think about how close Derek was to death. We would have lost a great songwriter, and this series would have been over by now. Thankfully, the doctors were eventually able to stabilize his health. Upon release from the hospital, Derek began his long recovery process, which included heavy physical rehabilitation. Between the drinking and being stuck in a hospital bed for so long, he suffered severe nerve damage from his knees down. He could hardly walk, and he had to spend a few weeks in a wheelchair. More so than that, he wasn't able to play guitar, piano, or any instrument. He had to relearn and redevelop the muscle memory for each instrument.
That probably scared me most, more than
lying in the hospital wondering if I was going to live or die, that was more scary because I didn't know how long that was going to take to come back. And I, in my head, I'm like, I need to start working now. You know, I need to start writing music, and I can't even play my guitar.
As a lifelong musician, that's a terrifying thing to go through. Being physically unable to play your instrument, something that defines you as a person. Derek's recovery process went on for about a year's time, and to him it felt never-ending. But over time, Derek's health began to improve, and he eventually relearned how to play guitar and piano. And soon he was back to working on new material and doing what he does best. And as Derek was making changes in his own life, changes would soon occur with Sum 41. We had to say goodbye to Steve-O 32, but we soon said hello to Frank Zumo. Prior to joining Sum 41, Zumo was and still is a founding member of Street Drum Corps. Zumo had met Sum 41 while out on Warped Tour with that band, and every now and then he'd have run-ins with Derek on tour. And following Steve-O's departure, Zumo reached out to Derek. At first, Derek and Zumo wanted to get together to hang out and jam, but it eventually turned into bringing the whole band down to LA for a week. And after the end of that week, Zumo was officially asked to join the band. And on April 18th, 2016, he was officially introduced as the new drummer for Sum 41. However, Zumo's first performance with the band was on July 19th, 2015, where Sum 41 played their first show in about 3 years in Anaheim, California. Now, admittedly, he's not the force of personality that Steve-O once was, but in terms of his drumming abilities, he's more than capable. Having both the fierce chops for the faster and heavier songs, but also the relaxed feel for the softer ones. And would you know, on his very first record with the band, he made a songwriting contribution. But we'll get into that later. And Zumo wasn't the only new addition to the band, but then again, I wouldn't call this next addition new. So picture this. It's August 2015, and for some reason, you're watching the Alternative Press Music Awards. Okay, more specifically, you're watching Sum 41 perform at the APMAs. They go through the first half of Still Waiting, transition to In Too Deep, the classic guitar solo is coming up, and then this happens.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. T. Brownstaff!
Yes, it's no sleight of hand, no smoke and mirrors. In the flesh, it's Mr. Dave Brown Sound. And that was pretty cool. But the real kicker is that this wasn't a one-time deal, as after this performance, it was soon confirmed that Dave was officially back in the band. Amidst his recovery, Derek and Dave started reconnecting again over the past few months. And after some discussion, they decided it was time for them to reunite as brothers in musical arms. We may have lost a member of the classic lineup, but then we regained one. You see, it's all about balance.
Ah yes, the law of equivalent exchange.
After the release of Screaming Bloody Murder, the band's contract with Island Records had expired, and so 13 Voices would be the band's first independent release, which gave the band a newfound sense of freedom. In July 2015, Sum 41 launched a crowdfunding campaign through Pledge Music to help finance their new record, and the crowdfunding campaign proved to be successful. Eventually, on May 11th, 2016, the band announced that they had signed to Hopeless Records, and their new record would be their first release for the label. Derek began writing songs for 13 Voices not too long after getting out of the hospital. He would write and record demos at his home studio and send his stuff to the guys, and the band would periodically come down to LA to record their parts for the songs.
We had a time where we wanted it to be out by, but there wasn't the same kind of budget time constraints that we have in like regular studios.
Okay.
It was nice to be able to like work in our own studios at home and just kind of send tracks back and forth and really get like a proper band feeling to the recording.
And this process continued for about a year. Our first taste of new material came when Derek teased some new songs on Instagram in mid-2014. And over the next year, Derek would continue to release teasers. Some clips made it to record, but some clips would end up unreleased. The interesting thing about the writing of 13 Voices was that the songs were written chronologically.
I mean, the whole record was written in chronological order, from the beginning, right when I got to the hospital, to the, right before we went out on tour.
And this chronological writing process had an impact on the song's lyrics. But we'll get into that later. And so after many trials and tribulations, 13 Voices was finally released on October 7th, 2016. So after going through hell and living to tell the tale, what does this record have to show for it? Well, we've got to the count of 10 tracks to find out, so let's take a look. The record opens up with A Murder of Crows, and the sense of grandeur is felt almost immediately. After a short fade-in, the track begins layering string melodies in a beautiful opening statement. Sum 41 have never opened a record with this kind of elegance before. It really makes an impression and gets you interested in where it will go. And simply put, things get louder. After the opening string section, the track gives way to heavy guitars and vocal harmonies, with a couple synth leads on top. There's a number of musical touches throughout this track that add to its character, one of my favorites being the reverse chords, which you can hear just before and during the first verse. I'm getting sick of hypocrites saying nothing. Got a feeling that I don't belong. The song talks about the friends Derek lost after his recovery, boldly proclaiming, "You're all dead to me."
Some of the closest people around me that had been with me my whole life and my whole career, sort of like my entourage, they'd all just kind of split on me. As soon as things got really real and really difficult, all of a sudden the party was over, they all kind of left.
An interesting thing about this track is that it has no repeated sections. A Murder of Crows instead continually evolves as it progresses. Between the string intro and the song structure, A Murder of Crows defines itself as something new for Sum 41. But at the same time, it doesn't feel out of character for the band. It sort of cuts the difference between the last two Sum 41 records. It has the polish and multi-track layering of Underclass Hero, while still retaining the gloomy grit of Screaming Bloody Murder. The only thing about this composition that bothers me is the ending. The track does a good job building excitement, only for it to fizzle out with three quick hits. As an opener, the track does a great job representing the record. Its dark cinematic sound can be heard throughout the vast majority of 13 voices. The pun is intended when I say A Murder of Crows is a killer opening number. Our second track is entitled God Damn I'm Dead Again. And God Damn is right, because this track is totally kick-ass! I can still clearly remember how amped this track got me upon first listen. The track is relentless, attacking the listener with an onslaught of loud guitars and passionate vocals. With a mix of punk energy and heavy metal riffage, it showcases that hybrid sound that Sum 41 have become known for, and the track is every bit catchy as it is tenacious. The chorus in particular is incredibly infectious, dialing the punk element to 11 with fast and fierce delivery. And I can't discuss this track without mentioning the excellent guitar solos.
Since he was coming back in the band, I wanted to leave something, like a section for him to do a long guitar solo over. That song says, "Dave's back."
It's a clear sign that Dave's back, and it's some of the best soloing Sum 41 have ever put to record. The guitar mayhem keeps going as Dave's second solo gives way to twin guitar harmonies, showcasing the band's newfound melodic range with two lead guitar players at the helm. But alas, something needs to be addressed. And this job calls for the plagiarist police. These post-solo harmonies are both rhythmically and to some extent melodically, similar to the outro harmonies in Hotel California by the Eagles. And these similarities lead me to believe that Derek had a hand in writing these twin harmonies. According to an interview for French magazine
L'Obs
that was conducted in February 2020, it stated that Hotel California is one of Derek's favorite guitar solos.
Third favorite solo, I think, is such a great one, is the guitar solo in Hotel California.
And generally speaking, between him and Dave, Derek's always been the more melodically focused of the two. So this may very well be an intentional reference to one of his favorite solos. And with two lead guitarists in the band, these kind of guitar harmonies are now possible to execute live. If you can't tell by this point, I really like this track. It's a shot of aggressive yet melodic adrenaline with some sweet soloing and a super catchy chorus. Fake My Own Death was the first track fans heard from the record, with a music video being released on June 28, 2016. I listened to this track a lot in anticipation for 13 Voices. After a short fade in, the track kicks off with a strong main riff and things really get going from there. Initially, Derek's somewhat distorted vocals in the verse were kind of off-putting to me, partially because his voice in general sounded different. But upon repeat listening, I became fine with it. Fake My Own Death keeps an active intensity going, with both the punky drive of the verses and the stomping groove of the chorus. For me, the only real low point in the track is the second half of the bridge. The first half starts with a change in riff, then continues with vocals and drum fills, finishing off with a tense bent note. It's a great build-up, but then we follow with the same riff we just heard. No significant variation or addition, it's just the same riff but with a different drum beat. I mean, it could have led into a guitar solo or cool change-up, and I was kinda disappointed when it didn't. At the very least, it doesn't slow things down, especially in a song like this, that would have been a greater offense. Now at this point, I want to talk about an issue I have, not just with this track, but multiple tracks on this record. My biggest grievance with 13 Voices has nothing to do with the songwriting, although it's not perfect by any means. No, my main issue with this record is with the volume leveling. There are numerous tracks on this record where certain sections, mostly the backing vocals, become louder than the rest of the song. And I don't mean in the sense of dynamics, it's not a quiet verse loud chorus thing. I mean literally, it's as if somebody took these parts, turned up their master volume, and called it a day. And when this comes up, it's kind of irritating. Take a listen and see for yourself. I don't know if this was a mixing mistake, or maybe this was intentional. Although I don't really see the benefit in raising your volume mid-song. Now, this doesn't ruin the track for me, in fact I think Fake My Own Death is a pretty kick-ass tune. But this production issue distracts from the song, and fixing this issue would have made the song that much better. As the first release track from the record, I wouldn't say it's the best representation of what's to come. It's not as dark or cinematic as the other tracks, but it's an up-tempo, high-energy rocker to get fans excited for a new Sum 41 record. And that certainly was the case for me. Our first mid-tempo track on the record, it's Breaking the Chain. This is another track to prominently feature strings, particularly with the intro and in the verses. Like Fake My Own Death, Breaking the Chain talks about leaving the past behind, although in a more blatant way. The verse has a calm atmosphere, but with a slight tension. The pre-chorus offers a straightforward build-up, and following in the trend of the first few tracks, the chorus has a huge sound and vocal performance. The track then really picks up on the bridge, with a double-time shift and kick-ass riff with harmony. And when the vocals come in over top the riff, it makes for a great addition and further energizes the bridge. For me, this bridge section is the highlight of the track. Even at a slower tempo than the previous two songs, Breaking the Chain retains a similar passion and energy, while still feeling a bit more relaxed. And here we have Zumo's songwriting contribution to this record.
It was a song that he and some other people had written at first, and he played it for me, and it wasn't supposed to be a Sum 41 song. He was just playing me some music of his. But I heard that thing, and I was like, I hear this as a Sum 41 song. Can I use that? Can I turn it into something?
So Derek, after asking Zumo if it was okay, took the song, reworked it, worked some of that Derek Wibley magic, and the result was There Will Be Blood. The whole track has a strong Halloween feel to it, with its ominous guitar and synth leads, descending lahs, and piano chords in the second verse. The lyrics also contribute to the song's dark atmosphere. The song talks about taking the souls of the young, burning things down, anarchy and destruction. It's a nice happy number for the kids. From its anarchistic lyrics to its backing shouts, the song feels like it was written with a live setting in mind, and it does get the blood pumping. The bridge section has a cool change-up, with a halftime groove and wicked guitar lead. There Will Be Blood is a track that's both swinging and spooky, and its eerie melodies make it a great track for the Halloween season. The title track 13 Voices was the product of an interesting writing experiment.
And I would just pick up a guitar and start writing, trying to write guitar riffs to the images I was seeing. One of my favorite directors is Tim Burton, so I'd put on Tim Burton movies. From what I remember, that song was like I was watching Edward Scissorhands and started coming up with a lot of that guitar stuff.
The guitar stuff he's referring to is most likely the intro, and with Derek watching Tim Burton movies, you can see where the music draws its influence. So after a solid guitar and string intro, we're met with a riff that mixes time signatures. Sum 41 aren't a band known for using odd time signatures in their songs, so it's surprising and interesting to hear it here. The first minute and a half is a great instrumental, but eventually we get to the vocals and lyrics. I like the swaying feeling of the pre-chorus, and the vocal melodies of the, I guess, pre-bridge section. Then at the bridge, that's when all hell breaks loose. It starts with a drum spasm underneath distorted vocals, and an unexpected self-reference comes up. For those who don't know or remember, 32 Ways to Die was the name of a drum solo off of the band's debut EP, Half Hour of Power, making it an obscure 16-year-old reference. Talk about a throwback. But you know what would make an even better throwback? Having a new Sum 41 song with a ska section?
Don't pick it up, pick it up, pick it up!
I'm telling you, it's a good idea! Think about it, some ska, skank of the devil, skanking bloody murder. I mean, 32 Ways to Die was the track right before Second Chance for Max Headroom. We're just one step away from ska 41 goodness. Now, I may or may not have a petition. Would you sign it? Let me know. Email me at ska41fan@scottmail.com. Unfortunately, this is another track to suffer from bad volume leveling. In fact, I think it's the worst case on the record. There's a volume spike right at the start and the end of the bridge section, and there's a really unnecessary spike right at the end of the track. Again, this production issue brings down the song a few points, but the core composition is still pretty good. There's some great instrumental passages, I like the gothic feel, and the 32 Ways to Die reference is a nice touch. So the title track gets a thumbs up from me. The second song released before the record's launch, War and His Music Video were released on August 25th, 2016. And even though there were three songs released before the record's launch, War was the only released single from 13 Voices. And I don't see why this is the case. I mean, they shot music videos for all three songs. You'd think all three of them would be released as singles. But anyway, more than halfway through the record, War is our come-to-be-expected Sum 41 ballad. And the song represents a tipping point in Derek's recovery.
War was probably one of the most important songs for me on the record. Once I had the song and all these lyrics and I read them back to myself, I'm like, well, I have to live up to this. I mean, I wrote this. Every time I had self-doubt or insecurities, I would sort of read these lyrics back to myself and say, nah, I gotta keep fighting for this.
The lyrics reflect his struggles to stay sober and his resolve to stay strong. And the song's tender vocal melodies and delivery complement these emotional lyrics. The verse melody in particular being a favorite of mine. The vocals and the lyrics are really the highlights, as the core instrumental takes a back seat. It's very foundational, mostly just outlining the basic chord progression. Another day in the right direction. I'm okay, but I'm left to question. So what am I fighting for? Everything back and more. There's a couple of small embellishments, but it's not much. Now that's not necessarily a problem, not every track has to be a flashy, riff-focused rocker, but that being said, this track could have used a bit more instrumental interest. The only significant musical break is in the bridge, with an octave-based guitar lead. And speaking of this bridge section, do you recall the alternate, or I suppose original, version of this bridge? There's an alternate version of War that has backing vocals over this guitar riff. This alternate version can be found in the music video. But these backing vocals are absent from the record version, and honestly, I prefer it that way. I found them to be unnecessary. War is a fine ballad, and I recognize it as an important song in the band's discography. Not necessarily because of its musical influence, but what it represents to Derek. God Save Us All, Death to Pop. Well, that's certainly a bold title. The third and final song released before the record's launch, its music video was released on September 28th, 2016. The lyrics talk about being genuine and the desire to feel something real. But does anybody else find it a bit ironic that a song called Death to Pop has the most synth work on the record? Speaking of which, I find the synth work on this track to be reminiscent of Linkin Park, the particular song that comes to mind being The Catalyst. I mean, both songs are in the key of D minor, both are played in nearly identical tempos, and there's even some lyrical similarities. Okay, that lyrical similarity is more than likely just a coincidence. You're gonna need the coincidence cop for that one. But it's likely that Sum 41 took inspiration from Linkin Park, seeing as they have before with the song I'm Not the One off of Chuck. But unlike I'm Not the One, God Save Us All genuinely feels like it's taking inspiration, rather than just directly ripping them off. Whether it's the punk flavor of the verse or the arena rock bounce of the chorus, the song keeps a good energy going. And this is the kind of continuous momentum that I thought was lacking in so many tracks off of Screaming Bloody Murder. The pauses in God Save Us All feel appropriate and well-placed, rather than interruptive. This is another song I see being written with a live show in mind. The pre-chorus and chorus specifically are very chantable, and they have the kind of energy to get the crowd moving. And although it's a tiny detail, that God reference in the second verse is a nice touch. But then we get to the bridge section, and things take kind of a dip, as I find the guitar riff to be kinda stock. You know, the bridge sections on this record are really all over the place. Either I like them, or I think they're lame. But overall, God Save Us All is lively, infectious, and it's the kind of track to add some punch to a live show. The Fall and the Rise. The song talks about refusing to give in and taking back your life. Its most notable aspect is that it has rapping in the verses, which helps to give it some character. It also makes it the first Sum 41 track to incorporate rapping since I'm Not the One off of Chuck. Talk about a throwback. You know what else would make a great throwback? A Sum 41 ska-
Knock it the hell off!
Okay, I already made that joke. To be honest, I don't have much to say about this one. Other than the rap verses, this song's music is pretty much just more of the same. I mean, it's still a decent track, but I could take it or leave it. The final track, Twisted by Design, is what you've come to expect at this point on the record. A lot of the songwriting traits shown on 13 Voices can be found within this track. The moody minor key melodies, the touches of piano and synth, and an overall cinematic quality. Being a summation of the record's sound is pretty appropriate for a closing track. Now at the end of the record, the song deals with the fear and excitement of facing the world after recovery. Now this might disappoint some of you, but to be honest, I'm not really a fan of this track. In fact, it's one of my least favorites on 13 Voices. So let me explain. The intro is painfully cliché. The lead piano melody is one of the most bog-standard arpeggios you could put over top the given chord progression. The guitar work in general is very plain, being both more of the same yet not as exciting. And the other instruments don't do much more than simply fill out the sound. Now that being said, I do like the chorus. It's got a good vocal melody, and it feels appropriately grand. But that's about the only section that really gets a significant reaction out of me. Everything else leaves me feeling indifferent. There isn't much this song does that hasn't already been done before and done better by other tracks on 13 Voices. After the second chorus, we have a single repeat of the main riff and a short bridge, before we're thrust right back into the chorus. There's some fiery vocals, the lyrics have merit, and I like certain sections. But as the big finish to Sum 41's comeback record, I find Twisted by Design to be underwhelming. To me, it's like being in an empty arena. It's huge and may look epic, but there's not much excitement to be found. I really wish we could have ended on a more positive note, but sadly, that's my opinion. And with the sound of fading guitar octaves, 13 Voices comes to a close. Thirteen Voices was met with generally positive critical reception. Critics praised the record's fierce guitar work and emotional lyricism, and it was the band's best critically scoring record since Chuck. Sales-wise, 13 Voices was an improvement over its predecessor. It debuted at number 22 on the US Billboard 200, selling over 16,000 copies its first week. It was the band's first top 20 record in the UK since All Killer. In October 2018, the record was awarded with the Impala Double Gold Award for selling over 150,000 copies in Europe. Compare this to 2011's Screaming Bloody Murder, which by October 2016 had only sold 52,000 copies. But sales figures aren't necessarily indicators of quality. What about the music makes 13 Voices a good record, and ultimately more enjoyable to me than Screaming Bloody Murder? Now, the reason I'm making such direct comparisons between these two records is because 13 Voices has a lot of stylistic similarities to Screaming Bloody Murder. It's also on the heavier side of the Sum 41 sound, it also has a gothic feel, and it also has emotionally expressive lyrics. However, my favoring of 13 Voices comes down to its execution. I find 13 Voices to be more polished, coherent, and focused of a record. You could almost look at 13 Voices like the refined version of Screaming Bloody Murder. With that record, Derek's focus was divided between business and pleasure, and he was taking a looser and less thoughtful approach to the songwriting. But with 13 Voices, after nearly losing it all, Derek had a new resolve and was more determined than ever to make a great record. He put more thought and passion into these tracks, and it shows. The guitar work overall is a notable step up, with a crunchier tone, better riffs, and well-structured solos and lead guitar. The dynamics and change-ups are more natural and well-placed. The energetic songs keep things going without killing their own momentum, and clocking in at a tight 36 minutes, 13 Voices eliminates a lot of the fluff found on Screaming Bloody Murder. And while it may not be a concept record, you can see a progression in these lyrics. Since these tracks were written chronologically, you can see Derek's recovery is outlined over the record. The first few tracks have Derek killing off his old ways and leaving the past behind. The middle of the record has him taking steps towards recovery. And the last track is the victory song, signaling that he's overcome adversity. This record has a level of cohesion and storytelling that Sum 41 had never had before, even with a theme-driven underclass hero. The emotional and personal lyrics are better able to shine, being set to more engaging material. However, 13 Voices isn't without faults of its own, the biggest one being the volume leveling that I've talked about. It honestly did sour my listening experience, and it's a problem I didn't expect to encounter. No other Sum 41 record has this issue, so it really signals out 13 Voices for its poor mixing. But my issues aren't all based on production. While the record has a strong opening, it loses steam towards the end. And closing on a good note is just as important as opening on one. Overall, 13 Voices makes for a great comeback. It showed that Sum 41, more than 15 years into their career, still had more to say. My favorite tracks are A Murder of Crows, Fake My Own Death, and of course, Goddamn I'm Dead Again. Even after all the comeback hype has faded, 13 Voices still holds up well, and it made for the best Sum 41 record in over a decade. Considering the events leading up to 13 Voices, it's kind of a miracle this record ever got released. But Sum 41 were back, and the band's future looked bright. So after coming back from the literal brink of death, where would the band go from here? Next episode, we take a look at the politically influenced Order in Decline. I'm Andy B, and thanks for watching.